Hello, I'm Loredana and today I will show you how to set up your local environment for testing smart contracts using Mist and Remix. I have recently started building decentralized apps with Ethereum and wanted to share some insights about the process. To learn more about the OnTrack contract that I will be testing today, check out part 1 of this video series. We will first set up a private Ethereum node, and then we will also connect to the Ethereum main testnet node, which at this point in time is the Ropsten Revived fork. So, private node. You will have a link to a gist with the commands in the description. You can also use testRPC for this, but now I am using Geth directly. We first set up the private node. I've already made beforehand the proof test folder where the chain data will be kept. Let's look a bit at these options. The IPC path is the path to the local pipe that Geth creates so that other processes can communicate with it. We will use this to open a Geth console in another terminal. We also give the path to the custom data directory where the chain data is stored. We can also see the dev tag because we want a private node for development. And then we have some tags to set up the JSON RPC connection if we need it for connecting our web app. Check the docs for more details on that. We can now open Mist. And we can actually do it by passing the IPC socket file path to the RPC tag. Like this. So this just sets the IPC path option automatically. Mist is up and I already have some accounts here. Let us also open a Geth console or a JavaScript console, using the get attach command and giving it the IPC path. And we will use this to start and stop mining so we can test our transactions. We are opening the Remix IDE for testing the contracts. And this is my OnTrack contract. As I said in my last video, it receives a deadline in milliseconds and two addresses for the service provider and observer. We will give all these inputs here, the deadline here and the two addresses. And don't forget the quotes. We can also assign Ether to the contract from here. And we can choose an account from here. So we'll choose this one, which has 1.71 Ether, and the other one, which will be the provider, has 1.23 Ether. By the way, we have access to the compiled contract data. So to publish this contract from a web app, we would need its ABI, which is the application binary interface, and the binary data. You actually have all the code that you need here. And I've used this in my example web app because now Web3.js does not have an option for compiling Solidity code through RPC, only through IPC. Okay, let's create it. And now we have to start mining because it's a private node, so no one else uses it. Okay, we have created the contract. And we can also see that we have less Ether. So 171 minus 0.3. We can change
accounts here, so now we are the provider. And for example, if we want to click confirm, we will get an error. Callback contain no result, guest required exceeds limit. So if you get this kind of error, just upping your guest limit doesn't do anything, doesn't solve it, because the problem is in your code. Or someone tried a transaction that is not allowed in code. Because confirming project completion can only be done by the client. Okay, so we click on completed, and this is something that we can do. Again, we'll have to mine. And here we can see the events that I've defined here. So if we look through the code, the event eProvider completed was logged. Now we can change accounts again. We are the client and we are confirming that the project was successfully completed. So again, the etime event was logged and the client confirmed event. And then, of course, the provider was paid. And we can see the event here. Let's look at how much Ether the provider has now. It's 1.53 and it had 1.23 before. So this was successful. We may see that our transactions consume a lot more gas than expected. And this can be due to code inefficiency, and it's something that I also have to learn more about. Let's do one more test where the provider completes the project but does not receive a confirmation from the client. I will put the deadline to be 1 minute from now. And click create. Let's start mining. We'll change the account so we can be the provider and say that we have completed the project. And then wait a little bit so the deadline passes. So at this point, the provider has completed the project, but the client did not confirm that the project was fulfilled. So when the provider clicks on request funds, the observer will be called, which is here. And we have used an observer that always returns true, which means that it considers that the contract has been fulfilled. The deadline has passed, so we request funds. And we can see that the provider was paid. Okay, now let's try the Ropsten testnet. We'll close these. And we'll use Geth with the testnet tag. And also open mist with the RPC option. Usually this should not be necessary as you should be able to choose to run testnet from mist, but it had some issues with that. And it kept connecting to the original Ropsten fork. We can see that our accounts have changed. And these are my accounts from Ropsten. And again, we can also attach to a Geth console with the same command but using testnet. In a gist linked in the description, you have some instructions of how to set up your testnet node in case you keep connecting on the wrong fork, and also a way to test if you are on the right one by comparing block hashes. And again, we can see the same IDE. And of course, we will have to change the provider and observer addresses that we used earlier with addresses that are deployed on Ropsten. So this is not a local node anymore, so it will take longer for transactions to complete, but you don't have to mine them yourself. And that's it. Thank you for watching, and do check out my other demos.